بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. In the name of Allah, the compassionate, the most merciful. To all of our viewers out there, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. May the peace and blessings of Allah be upon all of you. And we're glad that you're joining us one more time in the intersection of faith and reason, where our guest is Dr. Ja'far Sheikh Idris. Dr. Ja'far, it is good to be with you again, sir.
Thank you.
Last episode, we were talking about the rational arguments for the existence of God. And you spoke about Ibn Taymiyyah's views as well as others. And you just chose to speak about how Ibn Taymiyyah elaborated on that. And you gave us a summary of five or four different points that he mentioned. I believe it was the innate nature, that it is in the innate nature of humanity to believe in the existence of Creator. You spoke about the ayahs. And then you spoke about the cosmological argument there. And interestingly, you said that the Quran does not argue much for the existence of God, but mostly it's ayat leading to the need to worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I believe you also said that contemporary physics actually falls into the two options that that Allah gave in the Quran.
I didn't say physics. I said that
the atheists,
the atheistic physicists, or and even atheistic philosophers, they find that they have no choice. If you say there is no creator, then you have no choice except to say either that things came out of nothing or that they created themselves. And I found that some of them do say this.
And I think we do have a quote. In you quoted one of them, I believe, Davis.
Paul Davis, in his book, Physics, God and the New Physics. Yes,
he actually proposes what the Quran said. I believe you quoted that last time in Surah At-Tur. Am khuliqu min ghayri shay'in, am humul khaliqun. Were they created out of nothing? And or are they the creators of themselves?
So he opts for the first one. He says, yes, they were created out of nothing.
As ludicrous as that may sound.
And he is a great physicist.
And he's arguing for this.
Yes.
Well, let's see.
Because some people, if you insist for some reason that there is no creator, then you find yourself falling into this trap of saying something that is completely irrational.
Completely irrational.
Yes. No.
Remember, rational is what we're talking about.
No.
Let me just quote what he said, and I'm reading a small quote here. He said, and I quote, "No scientific problem is more fundamental or more daunting than the puzzle of how the universe came into being. Could this have happened without any supernatural input? Quantum mechanics seems to provide a loophole in the age-old assumption that you cannot get something for nothing. Physicists are now talking about the self-creating universe, that a cosmos that erupted into existence spontaneously."
You see, does this make any sense?
Interesting.
A cosmos that erupts. What does it mean? And he's using words. Erupts. What is it that erupts?
And he does actually say that. He said it's a self-creating universe.
Yes, it erupts into existence. Out of nothing. He could have said, it doesn't erupt. What?
Where would it erupt from?
Yes. So if you insist on the claim that there is no creator, then you have to. Some thinkers. Have a psychological explanation for this.
For the
fact that some physicists deny the existence of the Creator.
Interesting.
Yes. One of them said that they don't want anyone to interfere with the with the discipline. They want themselves to be the people who explain everything. Because if you say that this was created by a God, then it is the God who runs the universe. It is to whom people will turn. They don't want this. They want to be the people who are responsible for the universe.
And in the philosophy world out there, on the physics world, is he considered to be, is this theory gaining any ground?
This is not a scientific theory. I am glad you said this, because, and he himself, to be honest to him, in the introduction to his book, he says, and I am not speaking as a scientist, because this this is not, and there is no place for this in physics or biology or so. He is using his knowledge
as a physicist.
Yes, to defend a certain position that has nothing to do with physics.
Yeah. And I think what you're arguing is that even rationally speaking, mm-hmm. it really doesn't have
it
much
doesn't,
credibility
no,
in the process.
No.
It is what Allah said, أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ and he said, yes, we were created out of nothing.
Or no, he's saying that, of course, both of them, that erupts out of nothing, self-creating universe, that erupts out of nothing.
So he's saying both.
Both, no.
And then after that, I believe we spoke about some of the attributes that a creator must have. And if you don't mind, but you said this earlier as well, and that is, the messengers did not come to elaborate on people believe in the existence of God. Yeah. But rather it was to, if I remember your words correctly, it was rather to correct people's misunderstanding of what they thought of their creator.
And to invite them to worship that creator. That is the most important thing. In the Quran, it is repeated. Prophet so-and-so, prophet so-and-so. If every prophet, when he comes to his people, the first thing he would tell them, that I am invited to you, I am sent to you to invite you to worship none but the Creator, mm-hmm. whom you know and in whom you believe. See, that's the basic message. But then people ask questions. And prophets have to answer them. Someone says, I don't believe in the Creator. Sure. Someone says, yes, I believe in the Creator, but why should he send a person like you? Why doesn't he send angels? Someone says, why only one prophet? Why don't God say, and so on. And they have to answer questions. Almost all these questions were asked by the Arabs, to whom the Prophet ﷺ was sent. And I sometimes say that it seems that the wisdom behind, at least some of the wisdom, behind sending this Quran to an Arab prophet, that these people were very intelligent. Even the non-believers were very intelligent. They asked all the questions that could be asked. They left nothing for the atheists or that come after them. Every question that could be asked, they asked, and there was an answer
to these arguments, yeah. And these questions. Sheikh, I know you said that he was sent to the Arabs. Well, perhaps just so that our viewers do not misunderstand what is said here, he was not only sent to the Arabs.
Yes.
His message is universal.
Yes.
But initially,
but the first people
that he was with were were the Arabs. Now, did these prophets provide any rational argument for why themselves they were chosen?
Yes, but I think we'll come to that later on. We are now we now want to concentrate on the fundamentals to which the prophets were sent. So we started with faith in God. We gave these arguments, I suggest that now we'll talk about what is called the argument from design.
Okay.
There was this cosmological argument, and there is the argument from design, and both are mentioned in the Quran.
Okay.
Yeah. The argument of the difference between the argument from design and the cosmological argument is that the cosmological argument talks about individual objects. And it tells you that if you look into the nature of these individual objects, you can see that they must be created. So it is called, it is talking about creation. The argument from design does not talk about individual objects as such, but it talks about the relationship between them.
Mm-hmm.
And it directs your attention to the fact, and it is a very obvious fact, that that creation is not just a heap of scattered independent objects,
mm-hmm.
that they form a system, or at least every a number of them forms a system that serves a certain purpose. Even if this applies even to what we call individual objects, especially the human being. The human being, now you have eyes, you have nose, you have mouth.
There is harmony within these individual objects.
All of them work in unison to serve a certain purpose. And the universe as a whole is like this. You live on the earth. The earth is made in such a way that when rain falls, it is possible for there to be plants, and there is air, there is oxygen, there is light from the sun, and you are created in pairs so that the species will be preserved, not only human beings, but every animal. You have male and female, and so on. So this is the cosmology, the
design argument
from design. This shows that this could not have happened just by chance.
Mm-hmm.
This must have been designed by a creator. And this is mentioned in the Quran in so many places.
Sure.
So the evidence of ayahs can include this also, yes, because an ayah can be either an individual object or it can refer to the relationship between the different objects of creation.
Sheikh, we would like to take examples,
yes,
on how the argument or how the Quran uses this argument to come to such kind of conclusions. So please do stay tuned. We'll take a short break and we will be right back. So please join us after a short break. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. And thank you for joining us again in the intersection of faith and reason, where our guest is Dr. Ja'far Sheikh Idris. Dr. Idris, you were talking earlier about this idea of the argument for design, mm-hmm. and we were about to go into some Quranic examples of this
of the argument. Now remember what we said before, that it is talking about the relationship
between the creation,
between these different objects of creation.
Right.
You have in chapter 78, verses 6-16, أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ مِهَادًا. Have we not made the earth, it says in the Quran, mihada. And there is no good, I haven't found any good translation for that.
Could it
but
be something say, like cradle? A place of rest?
Yes.
A mattress, maybe?
Yes. But what does it mean? It means that the earth is like a bed or so.
A resting place. Yes. A lodging place.
يعني he did not make the earth of steel, say, or some metal, or so. So it made it mihada. And the mountains as stakes. Many scientists now, Muslim scientists, are talking about why are the mountains described as being autad, stakes, but we don't want to go into the details of that. Okay. And we have created you in pairs.
Mm-hmm.
He did not say that we created you. Created you in pairs.
خلقناكم أزواجا.
Yeah. And have appointed your sleep for repose. That's the purpose behind
sleep.
And have appointed the night as a cloak. Yes. And have appointed the day for livelihood.
Mm-hmm.
And built above you seven strong heavens. and have appointed a dazzling lamp, that is
the sun,
and have sent down from the rainy clouds abundant water, thereby to produce grain and plant and gardens of thick foliage.
We're talking about rain here.
Yes. So there are many, this is only one example. There are many verses in the Quran. Perhaps you can also remember some of them.
Sure. I remember, for example, in Surah Taha, when Moses was speaking to the Pharaoh and he said, tell me about your God. And Musa alayhi salam seems to allude to this, الَّذِي أَعْطَى كُلَّ شَيْءٍ خَلْقَهُ ثُمَّ هَدَى. He has given each creation its shape or mold, and then also gave it guidance. And then he goes on to say, الَّذِي جَعَلَكُمُ الْأَرْضَ مَهْدَى وَسَلَكَ لَكُمْ فِيهَا سُبُلَى. Again, created this earth. Sheikh, what I hear here is that the word جَعَلَى, it's not by design, but it's not happening haphazardly. It was meant
to be so
that way.
Yes, yes. Now, this is the very obvious. These are the obvious facts that everyone can see, that there is a relationship between the different kinds of creation. But some scientists now tell us something very interesting. They say, and according to the Big Bang theory, that the universe...
I'm sorry, Sheikh, but before you go on, if you can explain what that means, the Big Bang theory, so that we are...
we the make Big Bang theory says that all this creation that we see was not there. It came from nothing. We don't know, and apparently... it came from nothing. But then this is not as rationally accepted to say that it came from nothing. But what they are saying is that there was something like a primeval atom, and that exploded. And from
that explosion,
everything was formed.
Including us, animals, everything out there.
Now, they are saying...
I'm sorry, Chef, without giving an explanation to where that atom came from?
No, of course science cannot today explain that.
Okay.
And that's why it opened the door for questions, for religious questions. And interestingly enough, it was the physicists who started talking about the existence of the Creator, whether in favor or against, like this Paul Davis. Before that, before the Big Bang, it was thought that matter was eternal. And therefore, it doesn't need any
explanation,
any creation or so. And it was thought by some that the question of the existence of God and has been proven to be, and there's no God because matter is eternal.
Sorry to interrupt, but I remember when I was at school, we were made to memorize this a quote. المادة لا تفنى
ولا تستحدث
ولا تستحدث.
Yes, yes.
That matter is neither created nor does it come to nor destroyed.
Yes. In fact, this has never been true, even before the Big Bang. When I tell, by the way, this is an example of something that is in science, but is not scientific. There is no scientific proof for this. This is something like an assumption, and perhaps. Interestingly enough, in fact, this was a Greek belief, and this shows you how culture influences people's conceptions, even when they come to science. And some philosophers said that there is no need for this. All that science is saying is that matter is conserved. Matter is conserved. And he says that there is no contradiction between saying that matter is conserved and that it can be created and destroyed. And he gave the example of something like this, say, there is a hole here, small hole. I pour water from the top, and the same amount of water
drips down there.
So the level of the water will be
the same.
The same. In spite of the fact that creation somewhere. And destruction. And this one was not a believer or so, but he just said that this is not true. And even Newton, who is described as being the greatest physicist in modern times, he was a believer.
Mm.
And he did not say that atoms came out of nothing. He said that I believe that the Lord God created atoms in such a way that they, when they come together, they form molecules, and from molecules you have molecules of water, molecules of this, molecules of that. And so he was not an atheist.
Mm-hmm.
Some people use scientific facts to support their atheistic views, and we can use these facts to support the theistic view. So the anthropic principle says that the world was created from the beginning in such a way that people like us it supports the creation or whatever of people like us. And I can quote something from a very famous physicist who is sometimes called the Newton of modern times.
Mm.
It's, perhaps you know the name Hawking,
mm-hmm.
Who wrote the famous book A Brief History of Time.
Mm.
He says that this means that the initial state of the universe must have been very carefully chosen indeed. If the hot Big Bang model, there are certain models of the Big Bang, if he says if this is true, the hot model, right back to the beginning of time, it would be very difficult to explain why the universe should have begun in just this way, except as the act of a god.
Mm-hmm.
And I think he's not a believer, but but this is what he says. And he says that if the rate of the expansion of the universe after the Big Bang, if there was a very minute change in that rate, the universe would not have been
the way it is now.
The way it is now. So. Some believers add this to the argument from design.
From design.
Yeah.
Sheikh, of all these four or five different arguments, which one does the Quran elaborate most on?
I think it is the argument from design.
The argument from design.
Now, some Muslim intellectuals like Ibn Rushd, the philosopher and lawyer and so on.
Ibn Rushd, isn't that Averroes?
Averroes. He was of the belief that the argument from design talks about the attributes of God.
Hmm.
It does not. It is not an argument for
the existence of God.
The existence of God. But some other theologians, including Ibn Taymiyyah, said, no, it is both. Because if it says that the universe is designed in this way, it could not have come by chance.
There must be a creator.
There must be a creator. So it serves both purposes. It tells you about God's existence and about his attributes.
At the same time.
At the same time. Many of the attributes of the creator can be deduced from, can be seen in his creation. So it has both of them.
And I believe, if I remember you correctly, one time you said that, and in Arabic it was very poetic, that the way we know about God is either through al-kawn al-manzur or al-kitab al-mastur.
No.
The world that is observed,
no.
Or the revelation that
yes.
is now read.
Yes, and this is why we said also that one of the evidence for the existence of the Creator as are his words. So it is creation and revelation. Creation and revelation. Creation points to the Creator, and revelation points to the speaker. This speaker must be the Creator. So they are both an argument for the existence of the Creator.
Sheikh Ja'far, as always, it is such a great pleasure to be with you. And like I said, it seems that the more interesting this is getting, the time just keeps getting passing by us faster and faster. But we're glad that you were joining us for this part of our program, hoping that you would join us again next time we meet, inshallah. And until then, we say, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu, and so long.